All right, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. And where I am today, I'm here in Las Vegas, Nevada. And as you guys can see behind me, I'm just in like a new quote unquote modern housing complex that basically the houses are all two stories. So they actually have a lot of square footage, but unfortunately the lot sizes are very small. Basically there's like an alleyway size around every house in the, for the backyard, super tiny. But despite that, there's a way, even if you live in a new housing development, you could actually get a lot more land for not even that much more money. In any case, here in Las Vegas, it can be quite challenging to grow in the summer. And at the present time, it's near the end of the summer, not quite the fall yet. And we've been having some of the hottest days. It's been 110 degrees lately, you know, last couple days. And within the last month or two, it's been basically 100 degrees each and every day. So what I want to show you guys in this episode is actually how one of my viewers, and actually another YouTuber, is growing food here successfully in Las Vegas, and share with you guys some tips and tricks that he's learned along his journey. So what we're looking at now is the front of Chris's house where he has his garden. Now he's not gardening in the front yard. You guys could see there's all these desert adapted plants here. And many people think that you cannot grow in Las Vegas because it's the desert, it's too hot. But he's gonna prove everybody wrong. And actually, you know, he doesn't have a whole lot of gardening experience. You know, he's learned basically on his own by watching my and many other YouTube videos and experimenting. And I think this is a great way to start gardening and to learn how to do it, right? Is through educating yourself and trying things and seeing what works and seeing what doesn't. It's like you stick your hand on a burner, you get burned, it hurts, you're not gonna do anymore. When you see how sometimes you're not so successful, you're not gonna repeat that. And you're gonna try different ways so that you can be successful. And it's really not that difficult. So, you know, we're here in a new housing development, very little space in the front yard. Basically, one driveway is like for four different houses. And I think there's an HOA in this area, so they maintain all the front yard and all that stuff. Also in this area, there's an HOA, so you probably can't be growing like a vegetable garden in your front yard, but his backyard is free and clear to do so. So anyways, let's head into the backyard and show you guys what's growing on. So now I'm at the backyard gate to enter his backyard here. And the thing I wanna say before we actually enter is this. Basically, although the lots here in this housing development are small overall, there are exceptions to the rule. And if you guys are looking to buy a house, even rent a house, I'd always encourage you guys to get a house with the most land and the smallest house. In this case, you know, he got a corner house, which actually is the largest house, but more importantly, it has a nice larger lot. So, you know, this house was maybe $15,000, $20,000 more than, you know, an equivalent house on a smaller lot. And so for the $15,000 or $20,000, he got a nice large lot. I'm actually quite impressed on how large the lot is, plus the amazing view he has from his nice corner house here. So pay attention when you're buying a house or renting. Always get a big lot because you could grow more stuff. And even if you're not growing stuff, you always have more space to play, your dog to run, or whatever. Anyways, what I thought I'd do in this episode to make it really easy is I'm just gonna go ahead and pick up the camera, carry it in for you guys, and kind of show you guys around what he's got growing in his garden, explain some of the things to you, and then maybe we'll sit down and talk with Chris at the end of this video. All right, so now we're gonna go ahead and walk into the garden. And if we walk right in, look, hey, this is one of the little greenhouses that I have. He has some sensitive fruit trees that he's trying to nurse back to health. He's gotten them mostly on clearance at different places. I think he's got some $4.97 citrus trees that he got from Walmart in like little sleeves. And then he transplanted them up into like some nice 5-gallon pots. They're doing pretty well. And then aside from that, he uses this to grow his starter plants. In the spring, he has a compost bin that he says doesn't work so well, and I don't recommend open composting in the desert. It's too dry, and the compost tends to dry really fast. He tends to water it every time he waters his plants, and he says he's got earthworms, and things do break down just a lot slower than it does for me. And this is a nice backyard, really well thought out, actually. So along this walkway here, he has some blueberries planted, and yeah, they're looking pretty rough now. I mean, I came at the end of summer, you know, before the fall. So this is like after all the plants have taken their beating over, you know, 30, 40, 50 days of 100 plus degree weather. You know, you said he had some blueberry, he got a, you know, yield of blueberries before it got too hot. In addition, you know, around the edge of his yard, he has all these fruit trees planted, you know, some maybe 4 feet, 5 feet next to each other, and they're all different kinds. I don't remember them all. This is a Shiro plum. He's got a cherry. I think he's got different kinds of guavas. He has all the tags on them, so that's really cool. An apple, and let's see, another guava. They're all in different states, and they're all doing, you know, better or worse. I'll tend to point out some of the ones that have been doing the best for him, because he's, with all these different trees, he's seen what has done well and what hasn't done well. What has done well in the sense of growing are these guys, and these guys are beautiful. They're one of my favorite. It's a pineapple guava. So the pineapple guava, while it's been growing really well, you know, leaves haven't got too damaged by the intense heat. Today was like 110 degrees. It hasn't made any fruit. So that wouldn't be the first thing I'd grow if you wanted to get fruit, but if you wanted a nice landscape plant, it'd be perfect. He also has a nice setup for grapevines. So when he walks out his back door, this is what he looks at, man, like a nice grapevine. Now, yes, early season, he was getting some grapes, but you know, now it is later in the season. You know, he's got jacked up with some of the high winds. I guess he said he's gotten up to like 60 mile per hour winds here in his backyard. It's like really facing an area where it could get a lot of wind. And but yeah, it's like really laid out nice. He's got like a nice trellis system to grow all the grapes. I mean, this is just his backyard, nice little patio slab. That's where the main garden is. And then over in this space, he's like, you know, growing even more stuff in front of the grapes. So in this area, this is where he grew like the garlic and onions. And this is not too hard of a bed to make. Basically, you just use these concrete stepping stones. They're about like a dollar each. And you just basically pile them on up, put them next to each other to create little beds. And so kind of like the soil is lower at the you know, place where the concrete pad is, and it kind of goes up in levels until it goes to a little bit higher, you know, where he has his grapes. So all the soil here is mostly native soil. He did bring in, you know, a bunch of truckloads of the Rejuvenate, that's the non-biosolid soil from the local Vera Grow place. If I remember, I'll put a link down below to Vera Grow. This time of year, he's taking the summer off of these beds. He's just grown a few herbs in there. Looks like the rosemary is still hanging on. That's one of the easiest herbs to grow. Over here, he's got the goji berries and that have basically sprouted up from the other side. And this is the main reason why I have to come to his garden, is check this out, man. I mean, number one, you can see his garden. It's like growing amazing. I mean, here in the end of summer, this is looking really good. I'm amazed that all this stuff didn't burn up, right? And then also too, look behind, like the beautiful mountain view he has at his place. Anyways, we're here to look more at the garden and take you guys around. But he's planned this really well. So he has these like raised beds, and this is actually done the same way I did mine with these concrete blocks. So check the link down below this video if you guys want to see how to build this yourself. He actually went to the same place I bought my concrete blocks, and he actually got these concrete blocks that he got on special, because they're like the wrong color, so he got them like for like half off or something, which is an amazing deal. And he built all this himself. It just took him some time to lay it out, and I'm quite impressed at his work. They're quite level and quite good. It must have taken him a whole bunch of time to do that. And you know, originally this backyard was just these little rocks, not these big rocks you're seeing here. These are what he's dug out, you know, from some of his side beds where he's growing stuff, but these little small pebble rocks. So basically when he moved in, he had a blank slate. This was all empty. And he built one raised bed at a time. He's got like these different concrete pieces off Craigslist for free. You know, people didn't need them, the curbing things. And he like laid it out really nice. So like along the whole edge, like it's basically like a U. His backyard, he basically has fruit trees along the edge, you know, and depending on how much spacing between them, 4 to 6 feet spacing all along the edge. And even against his house, well planned out, he's got these fruit trees. Maybe we'll just start along with the fruit trees. And he's got different varieties of pomegranates. So some of them he's bought locally, some of them he had to actually mail order. And I'm glad that he has like different varieties of pomegranate trees here. I guess, you know, I've seen pomegranates growing in big bushes, so if he wants them to be trees, it might be good to prune them down as such. And then these last two, he has some dwarf pomegranates. So these guys he picked up at Lowe's. He's like a man of my own heart. He's like pretty cheap, or I'd like to say frugal, actually. And he got these like for $5 on like the clearance bin because they weren't looking so healthy, and he nursed them back to health. And these are the only ones that are actually producing some fruit for him at this time, because those other ones are a little bit young, but they're making small fruit. So he has yet to harvest one from these guys here. Over here, he's done all his own irrigation. Irrigation's not too difficult. And he has this nice box here for all his controllers. And this is where he has his sprinkler controllers here. Let's lift this up. Lift here. And down underneath there, and he has all his valves labeled, his wires like totally wrapped up, really nice. And before the water even comes into all his valves here, it goes through this box here, which is actually his filter. So he has actually a filter that he could just go ahead and easily change out. And this is a nice size filter. You know, this is probably one of the best ways to do it, although I would get a big blue filter, which actually has a lot more capacity than the standard 10-inch filter there. So moving on the edge of his yard here, this is his best performing fig tree that actually he bought when he was still living in an apartment before he even moved here, and it was in like a container for a couple years. And this is a fig tree. So if you want to grow the easiest fruit tree in Vegas, it's a fig tree for sure. Other ones I would choose are jujube tree, date palm, of course pomegranate. He has birds and whatnot here, so he gets these like little netting things to cover his fruit in, so the birds and other rodents that he may have can't get in. And you know, he's out here all the time tending to his garden. This fig tree looks amazing. In addition, he's experimenting with some things. So he's got some pineapples down here that looks like they're surviving. Definitely protect those in the winter. And of course, you know, he's got all kinds of other fruit trees. So like a lot of different stone fruits, you know, and this tree is definitely having some challenges. And that's just part of the whole gardening experience. You'll learn what grows well and what doesn't. I think this is a Indian peach. So it's got some peaches on there. And this guy's doing pretty good. I don't know all the kinds he's growing. But basically, what I'm gonna say is if you wanna grow stone fruit, you wanna grow apricot. They generally have less problems than peaches and nectarines, although he did say he got a really good nectarine that he liked a lot off his trees. And then, you know, coming back over here, he's got more fruit trees. Sometimes they don't make it, then he might have to replace them. And then, let's see, over here, oh, he's got some edible hibiscus that's not growing so well. And I would say that's probably maybe a soil issue because he hasn't put a lot of compost here, and it's a lot of native soil that can be alkaline. And then he's trying to grow some passion fruits up the trellis there against his back fence. Here's an apple tree, and he's carefully got all his apples covered. And you know, this is important to do. I mean, if you got a new apple tree, it hasn't really made that many apples. It only makes 3 apples a whole season, and then, you know, birds or bugs get it or rodents get it, man, that's quite sad. So yeah, he covers them all. And let's see, one of his passion fruit vines made it through the last winter and the other one didn't. I think this is the one he replaced this year. It's doing a lot better. And of course, more fruit trees here. Yeah, I mean, personally, like I would only grow really good performing fruit trees because I wouldn't want to waste my time or space on things that was not going to be productive. But you know, for him, gardening is like his fun, his hobby. Plus he wants to see what is possible. You know, he's went to some different master gardeners and experts in the area, like, hey, can I do this? Can I do this? And they say, no, it's not going to work. But you know what? He wants to find out for himself what works and what doesn't. Over on this side, he's got a lot of citrus planted, and to protect them from the sun, he put up this remesh, and the goal was to put up the remesh and then have these vining melons vine up them. So like on this last one, it looks like it's worked pretty good. Melons vined up it a little bit, and it's protecting the citrus down there from the sun. Some of them, the vining melons didn't really vine up so much. So then basically put over the shade cloth to protect the citrus, you know, behind it. So, you know, this is just about being creative. In addition, because the citrus is, you know, sensitive to the frost, which we kind of get a little bit too cold here for citrus. So that's one of the reasons why I wouldn't plant it, because I don't want to have to be babying my garden and maintaining it and doing things. He basically has like a nice frost cover, basically all situated, ready to go, you know, when he needs to pull that down over the winter. And of course, you could use this also for the summer to give some sun protection. And then below, he's making the best use of his space by growing melons. So he has a few varieties of melons. I don't exactly remember the varieties. He think got them from Baker Creek, and they're doing quite well. He's said he's eaten a number of melons this year, and this is probably the best melon patch I've seen in somebody's backyard here in Vegas. And to make sure he gets to eat his melons and not the rodents or something, because he has some kind of pest, he basically covers them in a little cheesecloth style bag so that they don't eat them and they could ripen up properly. Oh, and then let's talk about fertility. So basically brought in the compost, rejuvenate compost, and then he just basically put that on the ground, mixed it with the native soil. And that's probably my biggest suggestion, is to, you know, start to try to improve the current soil and bring in more soil, good compost as he is able and as he can get it. He's trying to cover the yard also with the wood chips. So, you know, as you'll see underneath all his fruit tree, he has wood chips. So this is a really good idea. Conserve the moisture, that'll reduce the water. Also, the wood chips will break down over time and create fungal dominated compost, which are good for your fruit trees. And in addition, he's using some ollas. So these ollas, if you just look here, that's basically like a pot underneath the ground, and you could just see like a lid on it. We'll pull that lid off here. And you can see basically inside there, there's just a lot of water. And so this slowly lets the water seep out because it's unfinished, unglazed, and that'll let the water seep out a little bit at a time to feed some of the trees around it if the roots are getting to the olla in between. So that's pretty much the around the edges. And then he has all these raised beds that are actually kind of built similar to mine, just out of the concrete blocks here, and just overgrowing with growth. He has lots of different things planted, and I'll try to cover those things. I'll cover them bed by bed, kind of give you an overview. So this bed basically has lots of different cucumbers. He grew lemon cucumbers that did pretty good for him. Looks like he's also got some Swiss chard in there. And here's a pepper plant right there. Oh, and then, yeah, I'm really amazed with all the different fruits he's growing. I mean, every one you can see that he's covered up. Oh, and then here's a little baby that he hasn't covered up yet. He's probably going to have to cover that one pretty soon there. Looks really cool. Grow your own melons. And then he has some, like, kind of bok choy right there. Some greens growing just to fill in some space because they grow fast. He grew some beans here that didn't do quite so well here. Maybe some yard long beans. And then as a kid, he used to eat strawberries out of the garden, I guess when he was a kid. So he wanted to have some strawberries. And right now it may not look like much, but the plant, it's still flowering and still has some strawberries if you look really hard. But strawberries are not a crop I'd recommend growing in the 100 degree weather. Of course, in the spring, he said he, you know, was harvesting buckets of strawberries, did quite well, but most of the year, it's just gonna literally sit here and not do much for you. Over here, looks like he's got a lot more cucumbers. So this bed, he's got some lemon cucumbers, and he's growing them successfully, looking really good. Oh, and I wanna let you guys know his watering cycle. So he has a drip irrigation, and it basically comes on 5 minutes in the morning, you know, before it gets too hot, and then 5 minutes in the evening. And so things are looking pretty good. I mean, some things are kind of getting burned up a little bit, but hey, you know, 110 degrees, these plants cannot seek shade. They can't go inside to get air conditioning like we can. You know, definitely having some challenges, but he's despite those challenges, he's doing really good. And let's see, some of the best plants he's grown are the peppers, you know. Some of the cucumbers might be getting jacked up a little bit, but the peppers, you know, they're just still growing strong. And that's why I don't tend to grow a lot of cucumbers, but I grow lots of peppers. Of course, another crop that's done really well for him is the watermelon. He has a number of watermelons that he harvested this year. And then, of course, probably one of the easiest things to grow and looks amazing in his garden is the basil. So his secret to growing the good, nice Thai basil is just clipping off the flowers as they come. And this guy just keeps growing. This is some of the greenest, deepest, richest, good-looking basil that I've seen in Vegas. The other thing that I'd say is that he starts things from seed, which is quite impressive. You know, he does buy some transplants sometimes, but most of his garden is planted from seed. Over here, he has more watermelon and actually some peanut that he grew last year that just kind of overwintered and came back. it's kind of looking, I like how it's kind of like really filled in here, so he's covering the soil really well with plants. And then switching over sides over on this side, once again he's trying to grow those long beans that he's got a couple, but you know, they really dried up a lot. You know, he follows like Jake Mace over in Phoenix and sees what Jake does, and he tries to do some of the same things here. Like for Jake, a passion fruits grew really well, so he thought he'd be able to do it well here, but they just haven't done so well. And I mean, my personal belief is maybe that's like the soil is just not really good. So over here is his pepper bed. This is probably his most impressive bed. Has lots of things growing. These two plants in the beginning here got hit by hornworms early. Lots of different kinds. I think these are the shishitos. Lots of peppers on there. And then over at the end here, he tried to grow the bitter melon, which I didn't do so well for him. I think I grew it in the past, and I think it worked really well. It was in kind of a shady spot I had it in, and I got decent sized fruit, but once again, not something I'd really try to grow. And then let's see here, more peppers growing. I think one of his favorite varieties, and check out these cool little signs, man. He makes these signs for his plants. Tequila Sunrise. That's impressive that he makes these little signs. And so I think these are some of his favorite ones that he liked this year. Look at the color on those guys. Doing really good. And then I think these guys did pretty good too. I mean, some of these peppers are loaded up, man. He needs to come out and do a pepper harvest. These are called the Anthony Romanian. So all these really cool varieties I've never been seen of. He gets the seeds from all over. Maybe Baker Creek, I'll be sure to ask him about that. But yeah, his peppers, you know, if you want to grow something that's going to be successful, grow the peppers. His peppers are looking amazing. And then flipping over to the next bed here is his tomatoes. So he's definitely lost some tomatoes this year. You know, tomatoes are not something that I'd necessarily recommend growing in Vegas, although you can do it. They do have challenges, right? Early in the season, before it gets too hot, they produce, and they actually produce quite well. But then through the heat, pretty much, they might set some flowers and make a few tomatoes, but pretty much they're just waiting for the weather to cool down, and as long as the plants stay alive, and when the weather cools down, starting in the fall, these guys will pump out more tomatoes until they hit the frost. And then his favorite variety to grow here in Las Vegas is this one right here. We'll go down so you guys can see the sign here. And that's basically the Matt's Wild Cherry. So, you know, these make lots of small little currant style tiny tomatoes, but you see he had buckets loads. Although they grow the best for him, he didn't particularly care for them so much because there's a lot of more skin area than actually flesh on there. So it's kind of like eating grapes, he said. But yeah, I'm about to try the Matt's Wild tomatoes here. I think this year my Sweet 100s did pretty good. And then going on to the last bed, looks like he's growing some lettuce. So he's growing some small lettuce, maybe some Salanova. That's like a greenhouse style variety, pretty good. And then he's got some other varieties, I don't know what kind. And basically that's because he had to fill in here, and he's gonna be planting leafy greens here in his raised beds here pretty soon, because we're getting into the fall. As soon as it starts to cool down and his melons are no longer productive, he's ripping those out and planting greens. So he's gonna have lots of different greens. But until then, he's letting all this stuff grow. So this is an experiment, and he found out that when he grows the lettuce, you know, it's actually quite bitter. That's actually probably quite good for you, because it actually is quite bitter. Those are probably some good different phytochemicals that are good and healthy for you. But for taste-wise, it's probably bad. I mean, I'd still eat it. And then over here, he's got more of those melons. So he just planted these melons, and they just grow like gangbusters. And let's see here. Let me see if I could find one for you guys. Here's one's all covered up here. And I think this is like from West India. And so these guys handle the heat quite well. Oh, here's one that he needs to cover up right there before the animals or critters get it. But yeah, this looks amazing. Oh, and then in the middle, he has some woody carrots that he probably should have harvested, I don't know, probably months ago. But even so, man, if the carrots get too old, right, I'd pull them up and I'd juice them myself. And so, yeah, this is quite an amazing garden that he's done here in beautiful Las Vegas. I think the next thing I'd like to do is we're going to go ahead and sit down with Chris and talk to him more about his garden. You know, why he's growing food, what he learned about growing in Vegas. And you know, while he does have some successes, right? Some things didn't work out so well. And so we're going to see how he handles sometimes when things don't work out as exactly as planned. So now I'm here with Chris, and you can check him out at Desert 2, that's the number 2, Garden LV on Facebook and also Instagram. And I'll post a link down below to his YouTube channel so you can check out some of his videos on how all this stuff got planted and how he does certain things in his garden. But today we're gonna ask him some questions about how he's able to garden here in Las Vegas, even with the full direct sun right on us in the afternoon, the hottest time of the day. So that's a good thing because his garden gets some sun, but a bad thing because it also could fry his plants, like some of his plants have had challenges. So the first question I wanna ask you, Chris, is why did you start gardening and growing food in Las Vegas? Probably one of the hardest places in the country, literally, to grow food.
Well, I've been living here for 10 years now, and even back when I had an apartment, I started watching your videos and saw you put together your front yard garden, and it really inspired me, and I wanted to have my own food grown the way I wanted it. And even when I was in my apartment, I grew some stuff in pots, and I always wanted to have a big garden. And when we bought our house, we looked for a place that had a big yard, and we wanted to have a place where we could grow what we wanted and see what we could do out here in Las Vegas. And you can see it's kind of working.
Yeah, no, I mean, I'd say it's working for sure. You got like a lot more melons than I did. I mean, I didn't grow melons this year, but some of the growth here is amazing. I mean, for those of you guys that aren't here, I mean, if you guys live in Michigan or something, you're like seeing this, you're like, oh, that looks like crap. But trust me, I've been to a lot of gardens in Las Vegas for being near the end of summer, 100 degree days. I mean, this today was like in my car in the drive over, I think it was like 114. This is looking amazing, and it has lots of food growing here. So Chris, what has been some of the biggest challenges for you growing here in Las Vegas?
Well, finding the right plants that will actually produce is the most important thing. You've shown a lot of different things that grow really well, and I've tried a lot of different things, and I do test trials with my peppers and tomatoes to see if those ones will show me any that are better than the others. Everything seems to grow, but some of them don't produce fruit. You know, you get a tomato that grows one or two and they dry out on you, or a pepper that doesn't fruit at all. So, you know, it's tough to find the right thing to grow in your climate, but if you keep trying, testing different things, I think eventually you can find the perfect one that will do what you want, whether it's lots of greens and greenery or lots of fruit in your tomatoes or peppers or whatever it is you're growing. You just have to keep trying and find the right thing to grow in the desert.
Absolutely, yeah, I totally agree. You know, it's all about varieties. I mean, if I planted certain things in my garden, it would look like trash because some things just don't grow well. They can't adapt to the climate here in Las Vegas. So I'm glad Chris is trying all these new and different varieties so that I could come over, learn from him. I could share with you guys. You could learn from basically what Chris is doing also. And of course, you could learn from his channel. So Chris, everybody always loves growing tomatoes. So what's the best tomato that you found, or maybe the two top tomatoes you found to grow in Las Vegas?
Well, this year in my tomato trial bed, I did 36 different plants with 12 different varieties. And the most vigorous grower was a Matt's Wild Cherry, though I didn't really like the fruits on it. They're real small and they were kind of tough. But the best two producers and flavor wise, one is called Nepal OG, which I got from Johnny's Seeds, and the other one is a black vernissage, which grew really well in the spring, but it didn't last so well through the hot weather. It's barely surviving now, and maybe it'll come back for a little bit more fall growth, but those were the two best flavor and best producers so far. I'm going to do a wrap-up video on my channel and talk about all of them, but those are the best that I came up with right now.
That's awesome. So yeah, I mean, I always encourage you guys to experiment, whether you live in Las Vegas or wherever you live, right? You might have your standards that you always like to plant, but always try a few new varieties, because you'll never know when you'll find a tomato or a pepper or whatever fruit or vegetable it is that actually grows better, that yields more, that maybe you even like more. And so Chris, what about on the peppers? Like, what are some of the peppers that you like that yielded really well for you and grew well?
Well, the the one that I hoped would grow really well that didn't do so well is the habananda, which is a new pepper that is a habanero style pepper, but it's a sweet pepper, so it doesn't have the heat. I'm still trying, and it's still growing. It just hasn't made any peppers yet. The one of the best is a tequila sunrise. That one grows upright peppers, and they're orange, and they're really sweet. And you have to pick them immediately once they turn orange. Otherwise, the sun gets to them, and they sunburn. But it's a really good flavor, and it grew a lot of them. And basically, all of the peppers grew really well. The Mellow Star grew tons and tons and tons of peppers, but they're real small, and they're not like a one that's going to give you a lot of bulk in your meal or whatever. Those are like a topper. Antohi Romanian, which is a white pepper, was a really good flavor, and those grew well too. I have too many. There's too many of them. They all grew really well. Peppers grow really well here in the desert.
Yeah, that's why I tend to grow a lot of peppers. And you know, I see that you're doing it in full sun, which is admirable. I started shading, a portion of my peppers this year because I was noticing some sunburn, some damage. But you know, you're having good luck with peppers. Do you want to say any words about that?
Well, I didn't want to put shade cloth, and I don't put shade cloth on any of the vegetable crops. Some of the citrus trees I put shade cloth over, but the most important thing I think for my peppers was when they were young, I gave them some supporting strings to hold them up along the bottom, because it's a little windy here, and three times a day watering. You know, you get a few minutes in the morning before the sun comes up, and then a midday spray to keep them cool, and then an afternoon when the sun's going down to perk them back up from their hot day.
And so your watering times will change, right? So like that's maybe in the middle of the summer. Now that we're kind of getting a little cooler, mm-hmm. you've adjusted it, right, to two times a day?
Or? Right. Yeah. Now that the you know it's still hot, but but you know we had a break in the weather, and it was 85, 90 degrees for a week or so there, and I took out the middle of the day watering just an extra minute. It doesn't really need it, and if that beat down sun isn't there, making the plants wrinkle up. So yeah, I change it in as well. In the spring I only use one time, and in the morning I water, because it just doesn't need as much. The sun's not as intense.
Yeah, no, I find the same thing. You know, it's very important to water the appropriate amount. Don't water too much, don't water too little. And getting to know that, you'll be able to sense that from your plants. You could get a moisture tester, you know, and like Chris, you know, just a couple weeks ago I lowered and took out watering cycles. It was like, oh, it's getting a little cooler, until we got hot again. But I'm like, I didn't need it. It was only like a couple extra minutes just to fill in. And you know, I could see my plants are getting a little bit too much water anyways. So that's something you have to stay on top of. So Chris, I want to talk about soil fertility. You know, that's another reason I believe people can be successful or not successful growing here in Las Vegas. If you have, you know, if you choose the wrong plants and you have poor quality soil, you got basically two strikes against you. And then when the sun comes out, that's a third strike and you're out. So, you know, Chris is working on getting the right plants and having good soil. So you want to talk about some of the soil fertility, things you've done. I've seen some of your videos in the past where you kind of go into this a little bit.
Well, all the soil in the whole garden is from ViroGrow. It's called Rejuvenate Compost. It's biosolid free, and that's the base of everything in all of the garden beds, and that's what I use for my soil. And then I've put in obviously worm castings, the Worm Gold Plus, and other worm castings that you always suggest. And coconut coir, I know is not a nutrient, but it's really important to keep the soil moisture correct in our climate. And the fertilizer that I use is the Down to Earth vegan mix, as well as they have a BioLive mix as well that has mycorrhiza and other things to increase the microbial life in the soil. And that's basically all of the stuff that goes into the soil to keep it going here, and it's worked. You know, I mean, what I have is good soil now, and there's none of the biosolids and none of the bad stuff in there, and it still has microbial life, and I'm still getting good plants out of it.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, one of the things I noticed about the Rejuvenate soil is that it's maybe not as broken down as I would like. It has a lot of woody material, which is good and bad. it's good because over time it's going to break down and make more nutrients. It's bad because you have a lot of wooden material in there.
It's true.
So have you used a lot of rock dust or added any rock dust or anything like that?
I do have azomite, and I don't put in as much as you do, but I've over the course of this whole process and building this, I've went through 2 44-pound bags to do all of these. So, you know, I'm not pouring it in by the pound, but whenever I top off the beds, there's definitely azomite going in, and you know, that's important to get the right nutrients in the plants. And if it's not in your soil, it's not going to be in your plants.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I think it's not like this nutrient or that nutrient, it's the best and you should only use it. I think I like to try to have a more inclusive kind of program where I include, you know, different kinds of worm castings and rock dust so that my soil has everything it needs and let my plants figure out what it wants. Of course, kickstarting it with the biology and the beneficial microbes and fungi are super critical. So I'd recommend things like compost tea, and he has some other different additives that he puts on. Oh, let's talk about pests. You know, it's kind of amazing. Like, I think my garden has probably a bit more pests than you have right now, because I've been traveling so much, I haven't been able to keep up with my white flies, and I got a few aphids, and I got to probably spray again. But what do you do for pests here? I've noticed that you actually don't have so many pests.
Well, obviously the best thing with pests is always to be in your garden and get out there and, you know, pick them off. The hornworms have done a number on me for some peppers and some tomatoes, and you know, I get a few white flies, like you said, and I didn't have too many aphids this year, but I have I've been using a spray. It's an organic spray from John and Bob's Products, who you suggested to me before, and I found this on their site as it's called Enviro Repel, and it's got citrus oil and garlic oil and a bunch of other natural things in it, and smells kind of funky, but when you spray it out there, it tends to repel. I don't know if it actually is killing the bugs, but I do have less bugs. But I find that I need to do it on a regular basis. In a, you know, if I do it every 7 to 10 days, it's not good enough. Every 3 days we'll get a good cycle, and you know, I'll be able to cut down the population of any of the bugs that are trying to overtake.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that comes to mind is when I was in my fraternity, they said, you know, what you put in is what you get out. And it's the same thing in gardening. What you put in, the effort and energy you put in, is what you get out. You know, if Chris wasn't here every couple of days spraying, you know, this, you'd have more bugs. And so, Chris, how much time do you actually put into your garden on a weekly basis?
That's a good question. I don't keep track of it because I do work at home, so I have time to come out here. But there's never a day that I don't come out. I usually come out in the morning and pick a few things to eat, and you know, check around what's going on in the garden. And midday, if it's a real hot day, I might come out and make sure nothing is needs water or anything like that. And then always in the afternoons, I come out and I water the fruit trees, some supplemental water, and they have ollas in between them, so I fill those up and take care of that. So, you know, roughly, you know, on a minimum, two hours a day, maybe. Mm. So what's that, 14 hours a week?
Yeah, wow, amazing. With just 14 hours a week, all this is growing. Now, here's the thing, right? In the beginning, he put a lot of hours to set this up properly. So you want to talk about setting this up properly, you know, and building all your beds and, you know, getting all your fruit trees to get everything as nice as it is now. Like, how long did that all take? And how did you do it? Did you do it in one day, or did you do like a little piece at a time and until your yard got looking really nice like it is now?
It was a big process. When we moved into this place, it was just rocks from the house to the wall. There was nothing here, and I had a plan and an idea of what I wanted, and I had to submit it to the HOA. To
even for your backyard?
Anything that can grow above fence height, they want to know what it is in our HOA. They didn't say, oh, you can't do that, but you know, they want to know what it is so that you're not growing a male mulberry or whatever the things that are they don't want in their neighborhood. But I made that whole plan, and they said there's no problems. And over the course of about 3 months, I did almost all of the heavy work, digging out all of the soil around the edges to get rid of the rocks for the trees, and then digging out the areas here. And you know, I saw a video of a guy who did a real good bed with these blocks, and it was a good plan, and that's what I wanted to do. And a couple of weekends, me and my dad, we trenched out for the irrigation system, did all of that, and then the loading in the blocks was the heaviest lifting of it all, and leveling them out took me probably 2 weekends to get them built correctly. And then 18 truckloads of dirt later, everything is here as you see it now.
So when did you start this actual garden?
Well, we bought the house in late 2014, and as soon as it was nice enough out to start working, we started digging and doing everything. So that was, February, and it took about 2-3 months before I was actually growing anything. So about May of 2015 is when we really got everything growing here, and obviously it's been a lot of seasons since then, and some of the fruit trees haven't made it through, and some of them are doing great, so we're still going, and it's still an experiment.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, I think that's very important, you know, to know that start off small and then expand slowly as you have time and are able to do it. So let's talk about some of the fruit trees. Like, I showed everybody all the different fruit trees and went around. You told me what they were, and I mean, I know some are stone fruit and some are this and that, but I didn't know them all. But what are maybe the three trees that have done the best for you that have made good yields and you'd actually grow again?
Well, the fig tree is obviously my pride and joy at this point. I've had that for 3.5 years, something like that, maybe more. It's probably a 5-year-old tree. I bought it from Home Depot in a pot, and I had it in a pot in my apartment. It's a brown turkey fig, and since I put in the ground here, it's just bigger and bigger and more figs every year, and it's a great grower here in this climate, and I've had zero problems with it. The water can be turned off and it'll survive for a week, or I can overwater and it'll keep growing just fine. Another one that's great, and I didn't expect it to be, was a Desert Dawn Nectarine. Mm. And the fruit was amazing. They were small, but I didn't expect a nectarine to work here, but I wanted to try it because I really liked those from when I was young, and I've grown it now, and that's a great tree, a Desert Dawn Nectarine. It's on Citation rootstock, which is supposedly supposed to be trouble with our climate, but for some reason it grows great. And my other two Citation rootstocks, the peach and the other peach over here, not so good. They seem to not like the hot weather, but for some reason that one loves it. Desert Dawn Nectarine.
Cool. So let's talk more about like cucumbers and then melon. So on your cucumbers, I know you're growing a bunch of varieties. Like, what in the past or this year has grown really well for you, like maybe the two top cucumbers you'd recommend for people?
Well, in Vegas, we all love the Armenian cucumbers or the striped Armenians. They grow amazingly here, and they produce out of control. I mean, you can pick them by the pound every week. They, you know, new flowers, new cucumbers. I really like those, but you got to pick them small for me. I don't. The bigger they get, you just end up juicing them, and I want to eat my cucumbers, and melons are what I love to eat. Cantaloupes and watermelons this year has been like the staple of my garden this summer. So I have this variety, which you've probably seen all the way around here, these huge leaves and these huge vines. It's called the Madhu Ras Rajasthan honey melon from Western India.
This one right here.
It's from Baker Creek Seeds, and someone with Baker Creek found it in a West India market and brought the seeds back, and I'm not sure if this is the first year or maybe the year before they sold those, and me and a couple other people from the Phoenix Fruit Growers have been growing them, and they're just crazy. The vines grow out of control, and you know, in just a few days, a melon will go from just, you know, an inch to, you know, like a full-size melon. I mean, it takes a while to ripen after that, but they grow really well in the heat. And even in the, you know, I was eating them in the 120 degree weather. You know, we've eaten probably 25.
Have you bricks tested them?
I haven't, but if you bring your bricks meter over, we'll give it a shot and see what happens.
Cool. I mean, on the back here, it says, let's see, these melons thrive in hot and dry conditions of Western India. So I mean, perfect for Las Vegas, hot and dry. That's where we are here. And I guess it was found by botanical explorer Joseph Simcox.
There you go.
I got to get him on my show one of these days. I know Joseph.
Right.
But yeah, so I mean, it's amazing that Baker Creek, you know, literally sends explorers all over the world to find some rare, unique varieties of different plants and fruits and vegetables. And, you know, they're one of my favorite seed companies. Now, their seeds don't always germinate as well as maybe they could be, but nonetheless, they give you access to extraordinary amounts of varieties. You could learn more about them at rareseeds.com. Chris, another thing I want to ask you is, why did you decide to start a YouTube channel and, you know, do the Instagram and Facebook about your desert garden?
I'm involved a lot on the different Facebook community pages, and I try to help people and I try to include people in gardening. And I found that a lot of the Las Vegas Facebook groups were not as inclusive as I wanted. So I wanted to do some of my own things and see if I can, you know, bring in some people to gardening and show them that anything is really possible. You just have to try and do the best with what you have. You don't have to worry about what everyone says is the right way or the perfect way or how you have to do it. You do what you have, and you learn from each lesson and go to the next thing and do your best with what you have, and hopefully you come out with an experience and, you know, something learned from all of your own process. The Facebook and the YouTube, I just did to share. You know, some people say, oh, you can't grow strawberries in Las Vegas. Well, I have some strawberries, you know, and all these different things I have. I wanted to show them off on Facebook to say, hey, do you want to see what I've got? Maybe this will help you, or, you know, I can tell you how I did it here in Las Vegas, and it'll inspire you or help you to grow for yourself. And we all should grow a little bit of something for ourselves. It's the best thing to eat, right? Come right out of your garden.
I agree. And that's why I started my channel, you know, to inspire you guys and teach you guys and show you guys what is possible. You know, I'm kind of like Chris. When somebody tells me I can't do it, like my mom, my dad tell me a lot when I was a kid, like, you can't do that. And then I'd have to, like, all right, I'm going to show that they're wrong and I'm going to do it. Like my dad said, you can't buy a house. So I've had to buy a house on my own without his support and help, you know, which I thought sucked at the time, but made me a stronger and better person. And when people say you can't grow something, I'll try to grow it, you know. But nowadays, you know, I've gotten a bit more wiser, and I'm kind of like, just want to focus on things that are going to grow really well instead of just I showed that I grow strawberries like Chris has done. Yeah, you could totally grow strawberries, but you know,
can come over and eat some of my strawberries, John. Okay, you don't have
I'll
to grow your own
them. Thanks. Yeah. But you could totally do it, right? And I always want you guys to be the open to the possibility, you know, especially I find with some master gardeners and things, they get into really like thinking with blinders on. No, you can't do that. You got to do it this way, right? And I want you guys to experiment. I mean, we're all on our own journeys. You know, one of the things I gotta say is good, better, best. If you're still using Miracle-Gro fertilizer, that's part of your journey, and maybe you'll learn one day that, you know, hey, that stuff does work. And I'm not gonna say it doesn't work, but hey, in my belief, you could do it a lot better if you added things to grow in the Miracle-Gro and then even got rid of the Miracle-Gro and did things differently. But each of us are gonna have to learn our own, you know. Everybody goes to the school of hard knocks, and some people have hard heads. You know, I'm quite stubborn in some ways, and it might take me a while before I want to change my ways. But when I prove to myself that something that I was doing in the past wasn't working well, I'll change. And you know, that's what it's going to take for some people out there. So I always try to be inclusive and show all different methods of gardening, even if some of them I don't agree with or some of them I have opinions on, which I'll share on my YouTube channel. And I'll leave it up to each person to figure out what they want to do, what they want to grow. So I'm glad for people like Chris here in Las Vegas, because I mean, I wish that there was a garden in every house on your block, and you're probably the only guy within maybe a mile radius with a garden.
Right, the only one with a big enough yard around here.
right. And so I'm glad to be able to share this with you guys, and I want to encourage you guys to get growing too and learn by the School of Hard Knocks. And the first thing, especially in Vegas, is whatever you do, don't buy bag soil from a big box store. 9 times out of 10, you're going to get bad soil, and things are going to be shriveled up. They're not going to grow well just because the soil is not a good balanced soil. You know, the rejuvenated is some of the best stuff here in town, but compared to some of the stuff that I've seen in California, it's really not so good. But even so, Chris is making the best of it and growing some good crops here by maybe supplementing and adding some things to it.
Some of my potted soil, I've used the Dr. Earth's, like you've said, is the only one that you would even consider. And I've tried some of that, and you know, it works, but it's nowhere near as good as real compost. Mm-hmm. The bag stuff, not quite as good.
Yeah, so I mean, Dr. Earth's is probably the best brand you could buy at a big box store if they still carry it, but a lot of the stuff is really not so good. So Chris, we're coming to an end today. The sun's going down, beautiful sunset. I got to get running, but any final words of wisdom for growing in Las Vegas or for anybody watching this video?
Everybody just grow your own food. That's all you really need to know. It's possible. You can grow anything. You know, just give it a try. You may invest a little bit of money to start with, but over the course of time, you'll find a way and you'll be able to grow your own food for yourself. And it's the best food in the world. Come right out in your yard and have a meal. That's what we all should do.
I totally agree, man. We all need to be more responsible on our planet and at least take responsibility for some of the food that you eat, even if it's not everything. And even if you live in an apartment and you're watching this in New York City or Detroit, you could grow some sprouts and microgreens inside your house. It's not really a big problem. And you know, one step at a time, and even if you fail, you succeeded because you learned successfully how to not do something. And so, yeah, thanks for having me out today, Chris.
Absolutely.
And come back. Somebody wants to get a hold of you on your and watch your YouTube videos, your Facebook, your Instagram, how can somebody find you?
Just search Desert2GardenLV on Facebook or Instagram, and you'll find me there. Or Desert2Garden.tumblr.com is where I have a website, which shares all the same things that I have on the Facebook and the Instagram.
Awesome. Sounds great. So I guess pretty much that's it for this episode. If you guys enjoyed this episode here at Chris's, hey, please be sure to give me a thumbs up. If I get a lot of thumbs up, I'll come back maybe like next spring before it gets too hot, and we can show his real garden, how it really looks when it's really kicking some butt. Also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes. I've coming out about every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,300 videos at this time. Teach you guys all aspects on how to grow your own food, especially here in Las Vegas, where you know I've produced many different episodes myself on how to set up a raised bed garden kind of just like this with these blocks, getting yourself from Vera Grow and some of the resources in town where you could source some of the different supplies so that you guys could be successful also at growing your own food here in Las Vegas. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.